Hello, everyone. Welcome to Lost in the Real. And today we are going to be going over two films that are quite quirky comedies that we have great nostalgia for. And we are going to be talking about how we felt about it in the past and also how we feel about it now. This is The Throwback.
Welcome back, everyone, to The Throwback. My name is still John, and I'm still joined here with Sean, the founder of Lost in the Real, and we have two pretty special movies, we think, to share with you today. What are they, Sean?
So the first film we're going to be going over is 1994's The Mask. This was a huge hit at the box office, and it was also Cameron Diaz's first role, which I found out when I was looking over it. I was like, what? That was her first movie? And it also stars Jim Carrey, of course, who, you know, I mean, he was such a hit in the late 80s and early 90s. And, you know, he's had such an incredible career. It also was directed by Chuck Russell. And it is based on a Dark Horse comic as well, which I didn't know. And it is about a bank teller who finds a mask and turns into an insane superhero / antihero when he puts it on. So, John, what did you think of this film when you first saw it?
Well, obviously, we were pretty young when it first came out back in 1994, so I can't speak on what three-year-old me thought it was like, if I saw it or not, but it was always a movie that I liked to watch, you know, if it were around, but I feel like it was something everyone knew about, but it didn't come up very often. It, you know, you didn't often just, like, see it there, like, at someone's house ready to watch. Like, no one ever said, let's watch The Mask tonight. Like, I don't know. That never happened, I don't think. But I always enjoyed the crazy antics of it, and I thought it was, you know, very memorable in its style and its obviously cartoonish, outlandish action, that it's almost like Who Killed Roger Rabbit. Obviously, a lot of it is inspired by those old Looney Tunes, but it was I remember always enjoying it for sure, and of course Cameron Diaz.
Absolutely. You took one of my checkpoints off, because the whole time I was watching it again, I was like, this movie is literally like a spiritual sequel to Who Framed Roger Rabbit. And not just because of like its cartoonishness, but also because of how dark it is as well. And I remember when I was younger, I liked it, but once again, like you said, I wasn't like, oh, this is the movie I want to watch, you know, but it is kind of a classic because it was such a hit at the box office. What do you think of it now?
Well, I really enjoyed it. I wasn't expecting to be as drawn in as I was. And I also saw a lot of parallels in its story structure, I guess, you know, kind of with Bruce Almighty as well. So it was almost like Who Framed Roger Rabbit meets Bruce Almighty, which is hilarious, you know, not just the Jim Carrey thing, but, you know, there's almost a, like, that scene when he finds the mask at the bridge, that's basically the, oh, smite me, almighty smiter, you know, like, it's just Jim Carrey being amazing as always. So, but it was, I guess the characters were also, like, pretty believable. Like, they were all, there wasn't, like, a huge cast of characters necessarily, you know, just, like, the police detective, there's, like, the bad, the two mobsters, but, you know, everyone had an objective, I guess, you know, no one was wasting time on screen, really, and it was very well made, I think. It was a true, true Hollywood movie.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on all of those things, basically. I thought Cameron Diaz, first and foremost, was just so charming. I don't know if it's just because she's so beautiful or whatever, but like I'm like, oh my God, it's so good to see you again because she hasn't done anything in so long. I also thought the CGI was really, really good for how old this movie is. I was impressed. I was like, everything looked kind of like, you know, I mean, it's almost been 30 years since this movie came out.
Do you think we saw like digitally remastered versions? I don't think so. I think it just looked like that.
I'm not watching
The Mask 2, which is about like the baby getting a mask or something like that, which is awful. And I think that looked way worse than this one. But of course, Mask 2 was made for money. This was made more as an artistic project, I think, like an actual movie.
And I love Tex Avery. I love the Looney Tunes and like just kind of bringing that into this character and also having it be silly and quirky and kind of obnoxious, but then also bringing in this like dark kind of like criminal underworld story. I really enjoyed that.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, not just Cameron Diaz looking smoky sultry on screen and Jim Carrey doing a really good musical rendition with all the cops doing their, like, big show dance. Like, that was one of the scenes that really stuck with me from when I was a kid. And, like, him in the club doing the wolf whistle. Ow! those are, like, it's the moments, I think, that stuck with me. After having watched the movie back in the day and now. So a lot of great memorable scenes. So that's always good.
Absolutely. There's definitely a lot of memorable scenes. I love the show tunes and the dancing and the crazy, you know,
with the eyes.
like it's a fun movie. You can't deny that. So how many Jack Russell Terriers are you going to be giving The Mask, Mr. John Willett?
Well, you know, it's funny. I think it depends on if they have a mask or not, because, you know, if I need some backup in a fight against the mobsters in the nightclub, you know, we're gonna need at least 4 Jack Russell Terriers. I mean,
no. Oh, shoot. Okay.
Yeah, I'd say 4, because, you know, perhaps if the movie came out today, some of the gags might not feel as fresh, but, you know, overall, I just thoroughly enjoyed watching it the other night, so I'd say I was pleasantly surprised.
I, you know, mirror a lot of your opinions of this film. I think that it was so much fun. I'll definitely be rewatching it again and not wait as long as I did in the past. I do think that some of the suggestive material doesn't really mix with some of the cartoonish, silly, childish material. But besides that, I really, really like this movie, and I'm really happy that we watched it. But I will be giving The Mask 3.5 Jack Russell Terriers out of 5.
You monster. You're just wasting a whole half of a Jack Russell Terrier?
Cutting one in half. Just slicing it in half.
All right, everyone. For our next film, we have a very special 80s classic that is pretty close to my heart, and most people tend to have a soft spot within them for this film as well, and it is The Princess Bride, a 1987 classic directed by Rob Reiner, based on a book. And also the screenplay is written by a good guy named William Goldman. And then it is starring Cary Elwes, Robin Wright, and some other folks like Mandy Patinkin, who you may recognize as Inigo Montoya, and of course, Andre the Giant, the man himself. But, although that was more of an Arnie voice, oh well, whatever. Sean, what did you think of this movie back in the day?
Back in the day, I did not like this movie at all, and everyone gave me so much shit for it. I don't care. People gave me shit for it, and I didn't get the love for this film. I thought it was, you know, just really over the top and kind of like just a replica of Monty Python. And I just... I don't know. I just didn't feel the love for it like everyone else did. And everyone was always giving me a hard time. I mean, we'll see what I have to say in a little bit. What did you think about it when you were young?
Well, I didn't watch it as a child. My first time seeing it was in high school. So it was recommended to me by a fellow drama kid. So, you know, I already had an idea of what I was getting myself into. But I definitely liked it a lot back in the day. But I didn't love it, you know. Like, I was like, yeah, it's a fun ride, but I wasn't crazy about it necessarily. But it wasn't until I got older that things started to change about that.
So a couple of things that I have to say now that I feel about this film is I feel like this is such a quotable movie. I kept like the whole entire time I was watching it, I'm like, oh my God, I know that. I know that. I know that.
Oh, that's where this is from.
Huh?
You're like, oh, that's where this is from.
Exactly. Exactly. And I was so I had a lot of fun with the quotes and the fantasy. And I thought it was very cheeky and ridiculous and a little over the top. And I was okay with that. What about you?
Honestly, I loved it and I enjoyed it way more than I thought I would. I knew I would enjoy it, but I, to be honest, just put it on in the background while I was cleaning my room, and I was immediately drawn into their first scene when the grandpa walks into that little boy's room and, you know, they have the cliche, well, I'm a teenager, what are books? Oh, in my day, these were movies, you know, sort of thing. But it had a great cinematic draw to me that I felt like I had to sit down and really watch the scenes, and it was all very enjoyable to be so drawn into that. Of course, it was very ridiculous in certain ways, over the top, cheesy, but it's, you know, solid action, solid choreography. Everyone's a great actor. Part of the cheesiness of it is, of course, intended. I consider this to kind of be a cross between Neverending Story and Robin Hood Men in Tights, because, of course, Robin Hood Men in Tights is also Cary Elwes, came out a few years later, and this movie was made in 1987, which is just one or 2 years after A Neverending Story. So there probably are, you know, similar inspirations being drawn into those movies, or rather, so you can see how, I guess, someone saw Cary Elwes in this and was like, oh yeah, he's my Robin Hood. So, because Robin Hood Men in Tights was hands down one of my favorite movies back in the day. But Andre the Giant was really great on screen too. Like, he, yeah, of course, you know, rest in peace, big guy. But he seemed to have a lot of fun, and his character was so loving. And, you know, he really gave himself to the role, I think, within his somewhat limited abilities. But it was all great. And, of course, the quotes will always stay with you, too. And, you know, the kissing parts were a little gross, but you can learn to enjoy those, too.
Yeah, I thought it was so much fun. I, like you said, like, you know, Andre the Giant, I think he's probably my favorite character in the movie. You know, I thought all the characters were, you know, endearing, and I just kind of fell in love with everybody. But at the same time, I also feel like this movie is still kind of basic and like simple. And maybe that is good for some people, but I just feel like there's not enough oomph, like enough story to this film. That's just what holds it back for me. But I still, watching it again today, yesterday, I did like it a lot better than I did back in the day.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Absolutely. It is certainly very simple. I had a feeling that some of the writing was more so just like it was all set up as an excuse to get to the next scene, to like set up a moment, to set up a quote or just a line, you know. But, you know, once you got to that moment and you got to that scene, and it all paid off really well, and It's an 80s fantasy romance, whatever. It doesn't have to be that complicated.
That's true. I wrote down like there's some great set pieces, but very dull transitions to
Oh,
those
yeah.
set pieces.
Like climbing up that cliff super slowly. But good
Anyway, so
film.
how many silly molestaches would you give the Princess Bride?
Oh my goodness. I'd give it four and a half. Four and a half mustaches out of five.
I just want to
Because,
shut them off.
yes,
Half your.
just, I considered doing a Wesley style mustache, but it would take too long to grow it back, so. But I definitely enjoyed it, and I will watch it again. Probably not within the year, Gotta keep it special. But what about you, Sean?
I will be giving The Princess Bride 3 out of 5 silly molestashes. And I do believe that this is a fun film, and even maybe on a next viewing, I might find even more love for it. But for the time being, I think it's a good ride, but I also still think it's kind of just a basic cheesy 80s movie.
For a lot of people, I'm sure there is a lot of nostalgia at work, so kind of swaying people's opinion, the rose-colored glasses, So, but part of the simplicity is also part of the appeal, Like when you put on a show you've watched 1,000 times before, just to give you that warm feeling inside, of familiarity, safety, contentment, just having a good time. This is one of those.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for joining us again on The Throwback. And please make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. We want to hear what you have to say both about these films and what we said about them. And who had the best mustache in The Princess Bride? Was it Inigo Montoya? Was it Wesley himself? Or was it someone in the background that we didn't notice? You tell us what you have to say. Thank you again, Sean, for another awesome time talking about movies with you. Can't wait to do it again soon. In fact, what two movies should we review next week or the week after that or, whenever the next episode may be?
I'm thinking the next throwback should be 2 franchise starters.
Ooh.
And I'm thinking the original
Sweet.
X-Men film and also the original Pirates of the Caribbean film, The Curse of the Black Pearl. What do you think?
I love it. I would love to watch those movies and talk to you again. Oh man, now that's definitely bringing me back to some cringy memories, but fun ones as well. All right. Well, thank you again, Shad. Hopefully, we'll see you all again next week.